I don't want to go into much about my story right now because it's pretty long and it sounds like a movie and it sounds very crazy when I think about how much God has done to get me to this point and how much obedience that was required for me to really separate myself from what I was doing and what I was into. But I'm grateful to be here. This church is like family to me. There are people that have been here that are much older than me that have been here. You know, when I came here, they were here, and families that I recognize, and I'm so grateful to be able to serve and bring the word of God. We're all family because we're all believers. So we're going to jump right in. First thing I want to share to you is a story about jury duty. Anybody ever did jury duty? Who thought y'all was cool when you walked into jury duty thing? Like, oh, wow, I'm an important citizen. This is great. So I had an opportunity to do jury duty a few months ago. And, you know, thousands of people are coming there every day. They give you $50 to serve in jury duty. It cost me $55 to park. So I was net negative five when I left there. So jury duty was wild because, you know, I got called. I was so happy on the first day because all I was thinking about the whole time was I need to get out of here. I got stuff to do. And then there's a criminal case and they bring you through the system where they're selecting the jury. And me being me, they asked me particular questions that I answered very honestly. And then they had to pull me in a separate room. We just want to make sure you're going to be whatever. So, and I end up being the foreman or whatever the what is it called? Yeah, juror foreman. I'm like, oh gosh, here we go. And when I heard it was a criminal case and I saw the evidence and I recognized the people in the room were all tired like me, were all ready to go home like me, I said, if any one of us decides that we're just too tired, this person could end up in jail. We just want to get out of here. And what was first an inconvenience turned out to be an opportunity to bring about righteousness, bearing witness to who God is just by being in the room and having influence over these 12 jurors. Justice, fairness. That's really what we're supposed to represent in society. That's really what we're supposed to be when we step into a room, into a classroom, when we step into a hospital, you work at a hospital, when you are at your job, whether you work at a Home Depot, or you work at a gas station, or you're a mechanic, your opportunity is to bring about justice and righteousness in the earth, but in the way that God desires it, and the way that a specific aspect of the kingdom of God functions in heaven is when Daniel begins to paint this picture of what this supernatural courtroom, as it were, looks like in heaven. And in Daniel chapter 7, verse 9 to 10, here's what Daniel says in this vision. As I looked, thrones were placed, and the Ancient of Days took his seat. A stream of fire issued and came out before him. 1,000 thousands served him. Call it 1,000,000. Then it says 10,000 times 10,000 stood before him. That's more than 100,000,000. The court sat in judgment. The books were open. And the Lord was seated. There's statutes. There's verdicts. There's a sense of legality. There's a sense of formality. There's order in the kingdom of God. This court is likely a room of God's witnesses. It has a jury of heavenly hosts, right? Elohim. It has the great advocate Jesus within that courtroom. There's thousands, maybe millions, even billions of issues that are brought forth. And when a decision is made on a matter in this court, those decisions are final. And those decisions transcend heaven, right? What's happening eternally, moment by moment, impacts the temporal here. One of those depictions that I think is, quite frankly, the most riveting, sort of an intimate, you get to see right into a moment in heaven when God is moving and when there's a conversation happening is what I saw in 1 Kings chapter 22. Anybody ever heard the story of Ahab and his false prophets? You know that story? Right, where King Ahab had a lot of crazy stuff going on. And this is not the particular story about when Elijah called upon God and the fire came down and consumed the offering. This is the story about the same King Ahab with another prophet named Micaiah. And this prophet Micaiah, Ahab basically begs him with also the king of Judah, the southern kingdom of Israel. He begs him, hey, man, you never tell me anything that's good, man. Everything you say is always bad. I need you to talk to me. I need you to say something. I need a word of God. And he's like, you sure you want a word of God? Okay. When you guys go to this battle, everything's going to be great. You're going to win. He's like, ah, you see what happened, man? You didn't give me the right word. He was like, okay. Well, let me tell you what God showed me. And then he begins to describe this intimate picture of a conversation in heaven in real time that God showed him. Here's what Micaiah said to King Ahab and the king of the south. And Micaiah said to King Ahab, therefore hear the word of the Lord. I saw the Lord sitting on his throne, as our brother said, seated in rest. And all the heavenly host standing before him and on his right hand and on his left. And the Lord said, who will entice Ahab that he may go down and fall at Ramoth-Gilead? Who in this room is going to entice Ahab that he may go down to Ramoth-Gilead and flop in a battle? And one said one thing and another said another thing. And then a spirit came forward before the Lord saying, I will entice him. And the Lord said to that spirit, by what means? And the spirit said, I'll go out and I'll be a lying spirit in the mouth of his prophets. And he said, you are to entice him and you shall succeed. Go out and do so. Isn't that crazy? It's like a setup. Justice is served. Now y'all can go home and read what happens in the rest of that story. But what's occurring in heaven is only to ensure that righteousness is done on the earth. Nowadays, righteousness has been simplified into rightness. And rightness for many people is now satisfied with just being right. But what if we see in Scripture the reality that God is painting, that rightness and righteousness is already pre-decided? Hundreds of times throughout the Bible, the king and his justice and his ruling and his righteousness, they're referenced over and over and over again. So us being made in the image of God, being who God created, it's no wonder why we in humanity are obsessed with rightness. We're obsessed, in fact, with being right. Let's test this theory out. Have any of you ever heard any of this statement said to you, or have you ever said this to somebody or thought this in your head when you saw somebody walk in the room? Something ain't right about him. Or, she ain't living right. I'm right, you're wrong. I know my rights. Even the Constitution of the United States says we are endowed by our Creator with certain unalienable rights. I had to practice that alienable word like 10 times because I was going to say something strange, but unalienable rights. How about you have no right? Or, man, do the right thing. Like Spike Lee. Only the real sneakerheads know that one. But anyway, here's one thing that I really want to hope is clear, that wonderfully PJ alluded to when he was praying that powerful prayer, that anointed prayer. Here's one thing that I want you to walk away with. If you don't hear me say anything else today, Christian moral rightness is not Christ's righteousness. Christian moral rightness is not Christ's righteousness. The idea of being morally right is littered in every conversation we have, the way we interact. Sometimes we don't even notice it. The way our politics goes and our frame of mind when we're making decisions. To be right somehow has now become the highest goal in a relationship. And what I believe was a genuine and honest attempt to Christianize humanity, we have then separated right living from Christ's righteousness, and now moral goodness has become a talking point, it's become a philosophical destination, and quite frankly, it's become an idol. Too many young adults are now finding solace in severing relationships. Being morally right, standing on our morals and values, has not brought the salvation and the unification to humanity that we thought it would. Right? Young adults have had to wrestle with this reality. They're severing relationships because of what they convey and what they've been seeing is righteousness versus rightness. First, it was ghosting, right? Such a big thing. You ask somebody a question, you're having a full-blown conversation in text, and you say something they don't like, and they just disappear. It could be something basic. Like, hey, you said you were going to bring that salad. Are you bringing that? And then they just show up like, I'm supposed to ignore that you just ghosted me. But now, there's a new phenomenon called going no contact. For a variety of reasons, some good and some not so good, many young adults feel that the only way they can be mentally and emotionally healthy is to go no contact with their parents. There's a growing sense of feeling emotionally unsafe and secure within their own family. As a parent myself, I have my own fears as I think about what it's going to be like to be a future parent. Are my kids going to go no contact with me? Young adults, I get it. Your parents' interpretation of you is probably way off. Parents, I feel your pain. You feel like one day your child just up and changed. One article entitled, "Why So Many People Are Going No Contact with Their Parents." That's the name of the article. One writer defines family estrangement as the process by which family members become strangers to one another, like intimacy reversed. That's still somewhat taboo. But in some circles, that's changing. In recent years, advocates for the estranged have begun a concerted effort to normalize it. Church I served in for nine years. July 14th was my last day this past July. 9 years is a big church. Lots of people equals lots of problems, even more pain. After the pandemic, member after member would come up and share, hey, man, you know, my daughter's just not talking to me no more. Or my son, like, he got married, he cut me off. Or siblings would come and say, my brother, he just, I don't know. I don't even know where he is. Now, I don't want to oversimplify the reason why some of that happens. But many of those conflicts arose out of an earthly political or social disagreement that actually exposed our ability as the church, our inability as the church to sympathize, to listen well, to engage in civil discourse, or in some cases, to share our faith with confident humility. Many of these breakups were over civilian matters. Some of us walked from conversations and felt like, hey, I did the right thing. We said what was right. We felt like we crushed it, only to realize that we crushed the relationship. Maybe even crushed the person in the process. In our zeal, maybe we've traded in a relationship for being right. But we as followers of Jesus, you know what Paul said? He said, you've been called ministers of reconciliation. Your goal and your will and your power in this world is when the Spirit of God comes upon you and you're able to mend relationships. In this ministry, we don't set the standard for living. We're under a standard. A standard, by the way, that is invalid apart from Christ. We cannot extract the goodness of God's standard and exchange it for morality and right living. But we, as a result of the fruit of the standard of Christ and his righteousness, morality can then spread through humanity. That's the paradox of rightness. The paradox of rightness. Or paradox is something that, at the surface value, seems wrong. But when you do more investigation and you gather more evidence, you find that this paradox is actually right. How can I live morally right and still be righteous in Christ? How can I live right, speak right, walk right, talk right, say the right thing, and still be righteous in Christ? In fact, what is rightness in the sight of Jesus? That's the paradox of rightness, because unfortunately, it is possible to live a morally good life, but not have the Spirit of Jesus. It's possible to live a morally good right, to be an upstanding citizen, to do the right thing, to never run a stoplight, to never go through the red light, to call out all the evil you see and not be a person carrying the presence of God. In heaven, in the court of God, there's no adjudication. Yahweh already knows the truth. There's no need to prove to Yahweh. He already understands. You can't hire a defense team. We can't argue our way out of his decisions. There's no plea bargain. There's no plea deals. There's just a just God and his justice. And as humans and humanity, we want to be right. We want to seek out justice. We believe that, when justice is served, that everybody will be made safe. But here's the gospel and here's the rightness of Jesus explained. Jesus came to give us salvation. Help us recognize that we cannot save ourselves. Then he gave us justification. He made us right in his sight by what he did. Then he gave us regeneration. We get to be renewed by his Holy Spirit when it fills up. And then we get to live a life of what? Sanctification. We're ongoing as we get to the throne room, before we die, we become more and more and more like Jesus till we get our heavenly body. That's what happens when you accept Jesus. That's what the righteousness of God looks like. So we're going to open our Bible and you're going to get your Bible reading in today. I promise you. We're going to go through a ton of scripture, and I just want to see the Bible paint a picture for you of what righteousness is, because I don't got no great ideas. All my ideas I get from here. So let's look at the Bible. We're going to open up to Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Romans chapter 3, verse 20. Watch the theme here in all these verses. We're also bringing a bunch of other verses. The scriptures say that precept must be upon precept. The Bible interprets itself. When we're gathering this evidence, we need evidence from multiple areas in the scripture to make sure that we're saying the right thing. So we're going to see multiple scriptures, but we're going to go through a bunch of scriptures in Romans chapter 3 first. When you get there, tell me amen. Amen, amen. Who was not there? I want to point you out. I'm joking. Georgios. Shout out to Georgios, man. He's the man. I love this guy, bro.
Praise God.
Praise God. Amen. So Romans chapter 3, verse 20 says this. For no one can ever be made right with God by doing the law of Moses, what the law of Moses commands. That law simply shows us how sinful we are. But now, God has shown us a way to be made right with him without keeping the requirements of the law, as was promised in the writings of Moses and the prophets long ago. 22. We are made right with God by placing our faith in Jesus Christ, and this is true for everyone who believes, no matter who we are. Ain't that comforting? For everyone has sinned. We all fall short of God's glorious standard. Yet God, in his grace, freely makes us right in his sight. Romans 3:25. People are made right with God when they believe that Jesus Christ sacrificed his life, shedding his blood. This sacrifice, hey, come on now. Where's she at? Amen. This sacrifice shows that God was being fair when he held back and did not punish those who sinned in times past. For he was looking ahead and including them in what he would do in this present time. God did this to demonstrate his righteousness, for he himself is just and fair. He makes sinners right and he in his sight. In other words, by his own determination and his interpretation of rightness, he makes people right when they believe in Jesus. Listen to what the prophet Isaiah said in chapter 59, verses 14 to 17. And when he says this, he's probably being prophetic, but he's also talking about currently that time when he was living in their judicial system. And here's what he says. Our courts here on earth oppose the righteous, and justice is nowhere to be found. Truth stumbles in the street and honesty has been outlawed. Yes, truth is gone and anyone who renounces evil is attacked. The Lord looked and was displeased to find that there was no justice. He was amazed. Amazed to see that no one intervened to help the oppressed. So he himself stepped in to save them. With his strong arm, with his justice that sustained him, he put on righteousness and his body armor and placed the helmet of salvation on his head. He clothed himself with a robe of vengeance and wrapped himself in the divine passion. In other words, left up to us and our standard of righteousness on earth, left up to our desire to be right, we'd be left without justice. But he himself had no choice but to make things right. Back to Romans chapter 3, verse 27 to 28. It says, and this is our focal verse, can we boast then? Can we boast that we've done anything to be accepted by God? No, because our acquittal, our innocence, is not based on obeying the law. It is based on faith. So we are made right with God through faith and not by obeying the law. But to all who believed him and accepted him, he gave the right to become children of God. John chapter 1, verse 13. What I'm trying to present to you is that the greatest human right that's ever been given to humanity is when Jesus gave us the right to become children of God. The greatest human right given to humanity is when Jesus gave us the right to become children of God. Our love for humanity, our hope that people can actually change, must flow from a heart that lives and knows that rightness that we have is based on the work of Jesus. That's why Christ's righteousness could never be moral goodness. When I was younger and I asked Jesus to reveal himself to me, I found salvation in him in this very church. It was at a youth event in Syracuse, and I wasn't yet regenerated by the Holy Spirit, but he was in me. And I walked my own way for years. I changed the way I acted temporarily. Then at 25 years old, I had a re-encounter with Jesus and I had a revelation of my own evil. Then when I look back, I think the way I was so disgusted with the way that I used to live that I began to look at every single person under a microscope, a spiritual microscope. Truthfully, under that microscope, what I was examining so closely was things that I saw in myself. I projected an unjust judgment upon those people, and with my new life as the standard, because I was ashamed of who I was, I began to judge people according to that standard. Seeking some sense of satisfaction in my faith and wanting to have achieved something after giving my life back to Jesus, I become self-righteous. If we're not careful, self-righteousness can begin to build a wall between ourselves, our families, and those of us who need Jesus. Self-righteousness often then becomes self-loathing. And self-loathing is described as a feeling that resembles self-hate. A feeling that constantly pushes the idea that you're not good enough. When we create a standard of perfection in our faith, people around us begin to feel judged by our standard rather than convinced by Jesus. They might feel condemned rather than feel convicted by the Holy Spirit. Then self-loathing, which turns into self-hate, causes us to hate others and eventually resent humanity. And the reality is, we don't need more people who know how to be right. We need people who know how to be relational. We need people who know how to be rested, not enraged. We need the kindness of God that is meant to lead us to repentance and turn us from wickedness. We don't need rage. We don't need a resenting of humanity. We don't need to detach moral goodness and right living from righteousness. They were created synonymously. Christian morals and values don't exist on their own. Only real Christians do. So I want to take a quick moment to pray that every righteous thought that we've ever thought we had that was better than the next person, every judging moment that we've saw somebody come in a room and had a preconception of who we thought we were, they are, that we would right now in this moment lay that down to Jesus and offer up our standard of rightness for his standard of righteousness. Can we take a quiet moment to do that? In Jesus' name, amen. Here's who you are in Christ, since he's made you righteous in him. The characteristics of one made righteous is willing to be wrong to save a godly relationship. 1 Corinthians 6:7. They don't demand their own way. 1 Corinthians 13:5. They keep no records of wrong. 1 Corinthians 13:5. They let go of past hurts through forgiveness. Matthew 6:14 to 15. They do good for no perceived accolades. Matthew 6:13. Big lesson that I learned. Generosity over investment. When we give to people, when we spend time with people, when we give up what we have, sometimes we may not have a physical return that we want. Sometimes we want this emotional satisfaction that something good's going to come out of what we did. Even that is not the generosity of God. When we give, we expect nothing in return. That is a heart filled with the righteousness of God. Luke writes in 6:35, "But love your enemies and do good and lend, expecting nothing in return. And your reward will be great. And you will be the sons and daughters of the Most High. He is the kind, for he is kind to the ungrateful and the evil." Our God is kind to the ungrateful and evil. And that's why I love your prayer, PJ, when we pray for Israel and we pray for Palestine, because from our limited earthly perspective, we have a judgment upon the situation. We have a way that we look at it, but all God is saying, whoever you consider evil, bless them. Whoever you consider good, bless them. Whoever you think is cursed, pray for them. Whoever you think has enough, give them more. Be generous in your kindness, in your compassion, in your prayers. And then it says, your reward will be great. We are called to be Christians who express tzedakah, the righteousness of Christ, through exousia, the authority and jurisdiction of the kingdom of God. We've been given the ministry of reconciliation that Paul says, and all of this is a gift from God who brought us back to himself through Christ, and God has given us the task of reconciling people to him. For God was in Christ reconciling the world to himself, no longer counting people's sins against them. And he gave us the wonderful message of reconciliation. And so we are Christ's ambassadors now. God is making his appeal through us. We speak for Christ when we plead, come back to God. For God made Christ, who never sinned, to be the offering of our sin so that we could be made right with God through Christ. So what will we do? What will we do? Is the good behavior that I've displayed enough to show my family members that unity is possible? Did my good deeds contain the power of Jesus to transform someone like me who gave into my addictions regularly? Is our righteousness worth anything? For I'm not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation. To everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith. As it is written, the righteous shall live by faith. Walk in faith. Allow the Lord to rid you of any preconceptions you may have about the world and others. And let the love of Jesus and the anointing of God carry you through to be the reconciling force that you're called to be in this world. You are an agent of reconciliation. You are to make repairs in walls, not create them. Amen? Can I just pray for us? Jesus, we thank you, Father. It's so difficult to accept the reality of who we are sometimes. We spend so much time, especially in the New York tri-state area, trying to work really hard to achieve things, to take care of our family, to do good, to be an upstanding citizen. And in doing good, we sometimes forget about your goodness. In trying to be right, we sometimes do the wrong thing. But Lord, we don't have the ability to encourage ourselves more than your Spirit does. So Holy Spirit, would you fall? Fill us afresh. May we be the reconciling agents. May we be the ones that unite families. May we be the ones that pray and intercede for ones that we call evil. May we be the ones, Lord God, that bring together people and not hurt cause harm. May we be justice bearers in that when God sends us into a room, we're able to bring about the rightness and the righteousness of God through love, through peace, through long-suffering, and through the faith that you've given us. We thank you, Lord, for who you are. We know we're meant to change this world through your Spirit. And we trust that you will do this through us. Make way and make room. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Can you say amen once again? Yeah. Let's stand across this church. Amen. Let's stand together. I know God is speaking to hearts today, and we don't want to miss what the Lord wants to do in our lives. And for some of you, it will be chewing on some things and carrying some things with you throughout the remainder of and as you go into this new week and going back to the scriptures and going back to the word. Others of you today, you need prayer. And there is someone that you want to talk to, someone you want to ask to come alongside and pray with you today. Before you head out these doors today, we want to invite you to come. In just a moment as well, we're going to do something so that we can once again not just say things, but that we can do things as well tangibly. And as you heard, Jelani was serving for many years, 9 years at a church in Ohio, and he has stepped out in faith with his wife in launching into just whatever God really has for them at this stage of ministry. And taking God's calling and hand upon his life and saying, okay, Lord, where do you want to lead us? And we want to take this opportunity to also to love them, not just in our prayers and in our encouraging words, but to love them in a tangible way. To love them in a tangible way. So we want to do a few things today. For some of you, you need prayer, and we're gonna invite you to come, and there'll be others beside myself just available here to pray with you. I would encourage all of you, regardless of where you are, maybe even today financially, just to say, Lord, is there something that you want me to do, even in a small way or in whatever way God would prompt you today, just to say, Lord, how can I be a blessing today to someone who is ministering in this way, in song and in the word, and I want to be a part of that. So I'll just invite you to come. Thank you, hon. If you could just help me. Thank you. If you need prayer, you come. If you want to be able to give today, you come as well. And we just want to be able to be a blessing today. And we want to be able to be open to all that God is doing today. So, Father, we just commit right now our lives to you. We commit this offering to you. And, Lord, we pray in all things that you would be glorified. Thank you for the righteousness of Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you. If maybe you could just minister in song and thank you. If you need prayer, you come. If you want to bring an offering, you come. If you want both to do both, you come today. You come. Thank you, Lord Jesus.
We build our life on you and your righteousness and your justice, God, and your mercy, Jesus. Use us, Lord, use us, Lord, use us, Lord. Worthy of every song we could ever sing. Worthy of all the praise we could ever bring. Worthy of every breath we could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Jesus, the name above every other name. Jesus, the only one who could ever save. Sing you worthy, worthy of every breath you could ever breathe. We live for you. Oh, we live for you. Sing holy and holy. There is no one like you. There is none beside. I will not. Come on, you know this one. Declare it with your voice. To Jesus I exalt.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Folks, listen, this area will be open and available if you need someone to talk to, you need prayer today. For those of you that are picking up children from either Super Kids or one of the ministries downstairs, you'll head out these doors to my right if you're picking up children. Once again, also, if you wanted to give today to Jelani and his family and the work that they're doing for the Lord, and we did not make this clear, if you wanted to do this electronically, just designate on that memo, just put in there Jelani, J-E-L-A-N-I. If you want to do that electronically, you could just put that right on that memo there as well. God bless you. The Lord be with you. May He continue to shine through you this week, and may He remind you, you did not simply come to church today, you are the church. So go and be the church this week. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. God bless you. We'll be here. Hey, Faith Online, we want to thank you once again for joining us today. Now, if you made a decision to follow Jesus, please be sure to click the Next Steps link below. If you're having trouble getting to us in person because of life circumstances and would welcome a visit from our care team, please let us know by clicking the Connect link below. Finally, if God's been using this ministry as a blessing in your life, we would love for you to do three things. Number one, subscribe to this channel. Number two, share this link with others. And finally, number three,
support the work of this church by praying for us and giving financially as God would lead you. Well, until next time, remember, living for Jesus won't always be easy, but it will always be worth it.